Audiobook, Simply This Moment. 8 Human Rights in Buddhism, 2. Dhammaloka Buddhist Center. 9 June 2000. Defining the boundaries. We also need some checks and balances, because we need boundaries for everybody. Sometimes when we don't understand the meaning of freedom, we remove all the boundaries, whether in the practice of religion, or in the practice of education. Whether it's living together as a family or just in general life, we don't put boundaries in place because we think freedom means no boundaries. We get into all sorts of confusion. In fact, one of the speakers at this conference, who I didn't really respect, said she was a Buddhist without boundaries. I was not at all inspired by her. Why do you even call yourself a Buddhist if you don't have any boundaries? To be a Buddhist, you've got to have boundaries. I accept some statements and ideas but not others, otherwise why call yourself a Buddhist? Why not call yourself a Buddhist, Christian, Jewish, Muslim, atheist, freethinker? That's not having boundaries. The point is, it's good to have boundaries. Sometimes people say, I'm not anything, I don't call myself a Buddhist. If you're a Buddhist, that's just being attached to a label, to a name. I ask them, are you a man? Are you a woman? Aren't you just attached to that label? If you are not attached to that label, when you go to the toilet, which one do you go to, the men's or the ladies? If you are not attached to being a man, go to the ladies' toilet and see what happens. You can see what intellectual garbage this is. I sometimes get really embarrassed by my fellow Buddhists. Tina Turner, when asked by a reporter, why are you a Buddhist? Replied, because as a Buddhist I can do anything I like. That's not being a Buddhist. Buddhists have boundaries. Creatures have boundaries, and it's the boundaries that define who you are. You call yourself a man, because that means you are not a woman, you're not an animal, and you're not a deva. You are a man. If you call yourself a Buddhist, it defines you as a Buddhist. Whether it's Tibetan, Mahayana, Theravada, Zen, or whatever, there are certain things that those labels require. At least you have got to believe that the Buddha was enlightened. If you think, well, I don't know if the Buddha was enlightened or not. Sometimes I believe in the Buddha, but sometimes I believe in Jesus Christ, and sometimes I believe in the Great White Ram. What sort of Buddhist is that? That's just a person who is incredibly confused. They are never going to get anywhere in this life. If you're going to go to Fremantle, you've got to get on a bus that has Fremantle written on the front, otherwise you will never get there. You don't have to go to Fremantle. You can go to South Perth, or you can go to Wanneroo, but at least choose the right bus and just sit on it until you get there. If you are a Buddhist, you should learn what the Buddha really said and what it means to be a Buddhist. But not just according to your own ideas. Buddhist means of the Buddha, something to do with the Buddha. The Buddha was a historical person. Everyone, even atheist skeptics, accept that much. The Buddha lived in India 26 centuries ago, and there is a lot written about him. Not just in old books but also in stone, in actual carvings on ancient temples. There are also carvings on stone pillars erected by the Emperor Ashoka. The Buddha existed, there's no doubt about that. With some of the other teachers, we're not quite so sure. You have to know what it was that the Buddha taught to be a Buddhist. You have to have some degree of faith and confidence in those teachings. They have to make sense to you. The reason I became a Buddhist was because I read a book about Buddhism that made sense to me. I read other books at the same time, the Quran and the Bible. They didn't make so much sense. By saying you are a Buddhist, you are not criticizing other religions, you are saying what you are. In the same way as being a woman, You say you are a woman. You are not criticizing men, you are just describing yourself. This is clear thinking. You are giving yourself a description that describes your reality at that particular time. With that description, you take on the responsibilities and duties of that reality. A Buddhist is someone who believes in the Buddha, in other words, someone who follows, as best they can, what the Buddha taught. Some Buddhists perform all of sorts of elaborate acts of worship. We talked about this in Malaysia, where they call it Joss Stick Buddhism. You might have seen Joss Stick Buddhists. They hold these Joss Sticks in their hands and sway backwards and forwards. They haven't a clue why they are doing this. They go backwards and forwards like this because they have always seen their parents and their grandparents doing it. Then they put the Joss Sticks into a jar. That's not what the Buddha taught. The Buddha taught that if you want to worship him, and this is in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, DN 16, you should follow his advice. A Buddhist is really someone who has gone for refuge to the Buddha and is practicing the Eightfold Path as closely as possible. Whether it's Zen Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, or whatever type of Buddhism, the one thing in Buddhism that everyone has in common is the Eightfold Path. In Mahayana Buddhism, they've got six paramis, or perfections. Three of those are sila, samadhi and panna, which is the Eightfold Path. No matter what form of Buddhism it is, you have to have sila, virtue. You have to have right view and keep the precepts. You have to have samadhi, where you are practicing some meditation and developing some panna or wisdom. So, first of all, learn what the Buddha taught. Try and realize it. See if it makes sense or not, and in the meantime question it. Listen to find out what Buddhism is all about. Question it to make sure you understand properly what the Buddha said, not believing it yet. Then try it out to see if it works by practicing it for yourself. Freedom of mind. Sometimes people think that keeping rules and having laws is restricting their freedom. That's why some human rights conflict with the laws. There is a conflict in many countries between laws which are designed to protect society and to give freedom from bullying, freedom from disruption, freedom for a person to enjoy their property, their time, and their own religion, and what people call the freedom to do what they want. I think this is the problem with the way that human rights are espoused at the present time. In Buddhism we realize, and the Buddha said this dash, that we gain freedom only within boundaries. We gain a lot of confusion, pain, and suffering when we don't have boundaries. Look at your marriage. If you've no boundaries, no rules, what sort of marriage have you got? The husband, if he likes a girl, can just go there, be free, and the same for wife. What sort of life would that be? To be able to have harmony and peace, we do need rules. During my talks in Singapore and Malaysia, I gave the simile of the fish in a tank. Are they free or are they in prison? Is it Buddhist to put fish in a tank, or should they be swimming free in the seas, the lakes, and the rivers? What have they done to get put in prison? Sometimes people look at the aquarium and think it's a prison, don't they? But that's misunderstanding freedom. The meaning of that particular simile is that the fish in the tank are free from fishermen, free from bigger fish, and they are free from too much cold and too much heat. The temperature is controlled and they've got free medical care because, if they are sick, the owner will come and see them and make sure they are okay. They get free food delivered to them once a day. Fast food, they don't even have to ring up for the delivery boy, it just comes to them. The fish in the tank are free from so many problems. That's why, when I really think about it, if I was a fish, I'd rather be a fish in an aquarium than a fish in the sea or in the ocean, in the rivers or lakes. I can swim back and forth, I wouldn't be able to go as far as other fish, but I would be so happy. I wouldn't have to worry about anything. I'd be just sitting in the corner of the aquarium with my fins crossed, meditating quite happily. Now you may understand, monks. We put ourselves in a monastery with a large wall around it, and people bring us food every day, just like a fish in an aquarium. But to live that life, we have to put boundaries around ourselves. Our boundaries are all the rules of discipline which we have to keep. This is something that people don't understand about monks and nuns, especially the lady who said she was a Buddhist. Without boundaries, there's no freedom at all. In fact, people who try that, who indulge in whatever pleasure or sensory aberration they like, who sleep around with this partner and that partner, get so confused, so depressed. We used to call these people screwed up in their minds. That is no inner freedom whatsoever. There is just so much pain. That's the reason that places like California, I'm not sure if it's true, but I think it's pretty accurate, probably have the highest ratio of psychotherapists per unit of population of anywhere in the world. One of the reasons for that is that there is a lack of freedom of mind. So freedom really needs boundaries. If we keep precepts, we feel free. The more precepts we keep, the more free we feel. It's the same with meditation. Some people say meditation is so hard, you have to think of the breath, but you don't want to think of the breath, you want to think about your dinner this evening. If you think of the breath, isn't that just another prison? That's why people sometimes even have the nerve to say that you can be attached to meditation. They really don't know the difference between freedom and attachment, between liberty and being in a prison. If you watch the breath and just keep yourself on the breath, you don't go anywhere else. If you put yourself in a jail with iron bars around the breath, you can't go anywhere. Do that for 20 minutes, half an hour, or an hour, and you feel so much bliss. The mind actually feels free. That is one of the fascinating insights of Buddhism. In fact, the Buddha called those states the states of Vimutti, and that literally means freedom or liberation of the mind. It's strange, but you have to put yourself into only one small part of the present moment to gain liberation of the mind. You can't even talk, that's against the rules. Imagine trying to impose that on people. On meditation retreats, we impose noble silence and only allow people to eat in the mornings. If Amnesty International found out about our meditation retreats, they'd probably complain. That's what is called unusual punishment, unusual forms of torture. I would think they would have a strong case for banning it. People who go to those retreats at first, because they can't talk, feel so uncomfortable. But after 2 or 3 days, the discomfort disappears and they actually feel freedom. They are free from the necessity of having to talk and having to relate to people on that level. They learn how to relate on another level. There is so much freedom when you're silent, so much more freedom when you stay on one point. What looks like a prison is actually the fullest liberty. It's called release, and it's the wisdom that is the truth. It's a very narrow truth. The truth of Buddhism is impermanence, suffering, and non-self. People often think that's such a small thing. Why believe that? You're just attached to one way of looking at things. Some people say that that's being attached to one view, and real freedom is having any view you like. You can believe in impermanence today and believe in permanence the next day. You can believe in God. You can believe in whatever you like. Nothing is right and nothing is wrong. Some philosophers end up by saying that there is no good and there is no bad. It's all relative. They say, in other words, that whatever you like is good, and whatever you don't like is bad. It depends on how you feel. Truth is relative. Anyone who believes in absolute truth is dogmatic, just stuck in one way of thinking. But actually the opposite is true. If you have right view, you feel so free. It's not being in a prison, it's liberty. It's okay to say what you think is right and stand up for it. Conclusion. Don't be a free thinker, which means that you think, think, and think. Be a no-thinker. Be a knower, not a thinker. All thinking is a sign that you don't know. If you knew, why would you think? It's true, just think about that. So, here I'm putting out some different ideas about Buddhism, ideas that actually show that human rights are a central pillar of our society. They mean a lot to us because they have consequences for the way we live our lives, consequences for the laws of our society, and consequences for the way we do things. Let us have another look at human rights from a Buddhist perspective, from the perspective of Kamma. Sometimes we have to suffer. We know why. It's because we deserve it. We caused it. Equality is the equality of opportunity, the opportunity to make good karma and to have happiness. All people are not born equal because they have all started from different places. Equality is in the equality to perform good karma and the equality to rise in happiness and leave suffering behind. So we recognize the differences in people, even from the time of their birth. People are not all born equal, but they should have equality of opportunity, and that's a beautiful thing in Buddhism. Everyone has the opportunity to make good karma. It doesn't matter how much you are experiencing the results of bad karma at this moment. If you're very sick, very ill, if you've just lost your job, or you're disabled, if you've just been in an accident, a divorce, or whatever else, there is always an equality of opportunity to take hold of your life. You can turn your life around to that which is truly wholesome, beautiful, and good at any stage of your life. You can do that. That's why Buddhism doesn't believe in fate, in the sense that, oh, I'm hopeless. I'm not destined to have a nice life, or I can't become a monk, I can't become a nun. In Malaysia, people said, well, it's all right for you, you were born with such good karma, that's why you're a monk. But I haven't got good karma. I can't become a monk. I ask, how do you know? I always tell people to give it a chance and see what happens. Test it out and see if you have good enough karma to become a monk. Give it a try. The point is, we can always do something. One of the other things which impressed me in Buddhism was that even a person who was a prostitute, someone who went crazy, and a serial killer were all examples of people who eventually became enlightened. In Buddhism, people with terrible karma had the freedom of opportunity, even in this life, to get to the very highest achievements. I think it is a good idea to enshrine in human rights not just equality between men and women, but more importantly to enshrine equality of opportunity. Opportunity for men should be the same as opportunity for women. It should be the same opportunity for any gender, any race, and any religion, because that is the Buddhist principle, not a Western Christian principle but Buddhist principles. With the Buddhist principle of forgiveness and kindness, it is not necessary to enshrine punishment into human rights. Nowadays, the victims of crime want to be the ones who punish the criminals. I'm not sure that is the law yet, but it seems to be coming. We seem to be enshrining in law the right to inflict revenge on somebody else, basically the right of an eye for an eye. But that's Judeo-Christian and Islamic, it has no place in Buddhism. In Buddhism, we have the right to forgive. It's good to forgive somebody else, but it is also a human right and also freeing to forgive yourself as well. That's a powerful freedom. It took me a long time to change my conditioning on reward and punishment. If you are guilty, you have to be punished. You have to be spanked, or go to your room, go. Without your dinner, or some other punishment. If you don't get that punishment from someone else, you inflict it on yourself. Buddhist human rights are the right to forgive and let go. These are just some reflections on human rights from a Buddhist perspective. Sometimes we think that the Declaration of Human Rights is universal, applicable to all people in this world, just because it came from America and Europe. I think that America and Europe need to look at the different cultures that make up our world, not just Buddhist culture but also Aboriginal cultures, to make these declarations relevant. Instead of just calling them universal, first of all find out what the people of this world actually feel, consult them, instead of just imposing these ideals that do not have a foundation in all cultures. The speaker at this conference was suggesting, and I thought it was a marvelous idea, that this Declaration of Human Rights is far from perfect. Let the Buddhists have an input. Rework it. Otherwise it's not really applicable and it doesn't make sense to many people. There are different ways of looking at things, and to look at things in different ways is called wisdom. These are some points on Buddhism and human rights, freedom and everything else. But it's just a start, because the whole debate and investigation isn't over yet. The whole debate and investigation isn't over yet.